Hello. I'd like to welcome everybody today to LifePlead Church's weekly service as we gather to worship God through His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Before we get started this morning, I'd like to just mention what happened to my wife and I this past week. As we were laying in bed about 12:30 a.m. during a storm, the tree, the very large tree outside of our RV that we live in full time, fell down on top of our RV. It landed right on the roof, right in our bedroom, poking a hole, several holes in the roof. And as you can imagine, it was a very loud, abrupt noise. We woke up very quickly, shocked, as you could imagine, shocked to find that this very large tree had fallen so very quickly onto our house. And I say, praise God for his love, mercy, and grace that we were uninjured. We were uninjured. We were just shocked, literally shocked that this would happen, that this could happen, and how quickly it did happen. So I would like to remind everybody how quickly things happen in this world, how quickly your life or your loved ones, family, friends, how quickly their lives can be taken, how quickly we can be taken away from this wonderful life that we've been granted. So I want to praise God, glorify His name through His Son, Jesus Christ, today and every day, that again, He allowed us this day, another day, to praise Him, to worship Him, our Father in heaven. And we do, and we are very blessed to be able to share this wonderful message with all of you who are out there watching and listening, seeking Christ. And so, again, I just want to praise God for the way He laid that tree down so carefully as to not hurt my wife and I. I give Him all the credit, all the glory for allowing us to be alive, to share this testimony of His grace, His mercy that He allows each and every one of us as we wake up this morning and have sight in our eyes, the breath in our lungs, the movement of our bodies, and the ability to praise Him, to worship Him. And so, again, I just want to praise the Father in heaven today. And we are fine. We are uninjured. We dusted off the leaves and the branches and removed the debris. I patched up the holes and did a few adjustments here and there. And here we are again this morning. So, something to think about. Each and every one of us needs to think about how quickly life comes and how quickly life is taken away. So put that in the forefront of your mind today as we begin this wonderful message. Now let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come before You to praise and worship You through Your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, we thank You for Your Holy Spirit that You have granted to all who believe in Jesus. We lift up our hearts, our eyes, our hands, our voices, and all we have to You in surrender. We surrender to your glory. I pray that our worship is pleasing in your sight. For you alone are worthy of all our praises. And it is through Christ Jesus, I pray, and all who would believe would say, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now this morning, I'd like to call up my wife, Stacy, to sing for us. Stacy.
Good morning. Your grace still amazes me.
you for sharing. That was beautiful. That was beautiful. Are you amazed by God's grace? Does His grace still amaze you each and every day? I hope so. I hope you seek out His grace. I hope you seek out His grace daily through His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, where it can be found. So let's praise the Lord today. Let's praise the Father in heaven on this day. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, I am still amazed and always will be by Your love, Your mercy, and Your grace that You have granted to us all. Thank You, Father, for this day and this opportunity to serve You for Your glory alone, and that Your will be done. Thank You for this life and all that You have given us. Without You, we would have nothing. Help me today to proclaim Your holy word to those that You would have hear it, those that You would draw in. Father, I pray that all would come to the knowledge of the truth and worship You through our only Savior, by His amazing grace, Your Son, our Lord and King, Jesus Christ. And all who would believe would say, Amen. Amen and hallelujah. Amen. Today, we're going to start off in the Holy Bible in the book of John, chapter 13, verses 1 through 17. John, chapter 13, verses 1 through 17. Read along with me. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that His hour was come, that He should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved His own which were in this world, He loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray Him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into His hands, and that He was come from God and went to God, He riseth from the supper and laid aside His garments and took a towel and girded Himself. After that, He poureth water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith He was girded. Then cometh He to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto Him, Lord, dost Thou wash my feet? Jesus answered and said unto him, What I do Thou knowest not now, but Thou shalt know hereafter. Peter saith unto Him, Thou shalt never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, If I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. Now Simon Peter saith unto Him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, He that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet, but is clean every whit. And ye are clean, but not all. For He knew who should betray Him. Therefore said He, Ye are not all clean. For He knew who should betray Him. Therefore He said, Ye are not all clean. So after He washed their feet, and He had taken His garments, He was set down again. He said unto them, Know ye what I have done to you? Ye call me Master and Lord, and ye say well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that ye should do as I have done to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that is sent greater than he that sent him. If ye know these things, happy are ye if ye do them. The Bible is very clear in the examples that have been written for all who would be servants to the Master. In order for us to be truly happy, we must humbly allow the truth in our lives through God's Word, understanding that it's the only way for us. It's the only way for us to become clean and pure of heart. Have you allowed God's Word to cleanse you? Have you been set free? Are you washed in the blood of Jesus Christ? Think about these questions today. Think about the questions that the Holy Spirit poses today for you and for all who hear this message. Now, today's message is entitled, A Pure Heart. A Pure Heart. And Jesus makes it clear how crucial it is to all that serve Him, how they must be spiritually washed and cleansed by His blood through His Word before ever being able to serve Him. It must be washed clean by the blood of Jesus. We as believers are not made clean through a physical or ceremonial washing. It is only by the blood of Christ, by the blood of Christ, that we can truly be cleansed. We must be washed clean through the blood of Jesus Christ alone in order to receive our pure heart. Our pure heart. Now in Hebrews chapter 9, verses 8 through 14, the Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meats and drinks and diverse washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation. But Christ, being come in high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us all, for us. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? My friends, remember that Jesus lived. He died. He was buried in a borrowed tomb. He rose again on the third day, as the scriptures tell us. He gave himself back to God as a sacrifice for the sins of the world. He allowed himself to be nailed to the tree at Calvary and his side to be pierced for us to have a way, the only way, to God the Father in heaven is by Jesus. In the Bible, in the book of Revelations, chapter 1, verses 4 through 6, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is, and which was, and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Amen. We must remember Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, the only way to the Father in heaven. And he is alive now for us. He is alive now amongst us. He is the only one with the power to wash us clean with his blood. It is through our belief on him, on his sacrifice at the cross, that we found that we find salvation for our souls. Where would we be today? Where would our souls be today without his grace and mercy and the offer of salvation through his sacrifice that he made on the cross? Where would we be? Where would you be? In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 7 through 10, Ephesians 1, 7 through 10, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mysteries of his will according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are in earth, even in him. We cannot declare ourselves to be washed clean, pure of heart, free from responsibility of sin, as Pilate himself attempted to do before he released Jesus to the people who then crucified him. We cannot wash ourselves clean of our sins. We cannot wash ourselves clean of the responsibility of our sins. Only Jesus Christ can do this. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 24 explains, when Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it. See ye to it. He washed his hands. He washed his hands of the responsibility that was to crucify Jesus Christ. He washed his hands and he gave it back to the people. He said, see ye to do it. To it. His efforts, Pilate's efforts, was futile. Just as ours are futile when we try to make ourselves clean from the outside in by our own efforts and our own means. The ceremonial law of washing is empty and has no power to cleanse or save. You cannot wash away sins. You cannot wash away murder. You cannot wash it away on your own. There is only one who can cleanse us, and his name above all names is Jesus Christ. Jesus. Have you ever tried to hide from your sins? Have you ever tried to hide from God the sins that you've committed? Trying to wash them away, forget about them, disguise them in some way, blame them on someone else. Yeah, I think we've all encountered this in our lives where we've sinned against God. We've sinned against God and we've tried to hide our sins, tried to wash ourselves clean. We've tried to make the outside appearance that we've done nothing wrong, to fool everyone, to fool God. You know, if you look at the streets today, the houses, you drive along the streets and you look at the houses, you know, they're all different. Everybody's got their own little place and, you know, people are doing whatever they're doing. But you look at the outside of some of these houses and you see people that they spend so much time on the outside, fixing and cleaning and painting and bushes and trees and plants and grass and fences and cars and all these wonderful things on the outside. They look, wow, they look perfect. The people must be perfect because look at the outside appearance of them. It's perfect. How could there be anything wrong with these people? But God knows that it's not the outside of us that matters. It's the inside. It's what's going on the inside. The outside of these houses may be perfect, but we don't know what's going on the inside. But God does. God does. Remember, you can't hide from God. You can't cover up your sins. You can't wash yourself clean from sin. Only Jesus Christ. Only Jesus Christ can wash you clean by his blood. By his blood. In Mark chapter 7, verses 14 through 23. And when he had called all the people unto him, he said unto them, hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand. There is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are they that defile the man. If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. And when he was entered into the house from the people, his disciples asked him concerning the parable. And he said unto them, are ye so without understanding also? Do ye not perceive that whatsoever thing from without entereth into the man, it cannot defile him? Because it entereth not into his heart. It entereth not into his heart, but into his belly, and goeth out in the drought, purging all meats. And he said, that which cometh out of the man, that defileth the man. For whom within, from within, out of the heart of men proceedeth evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defileth the man. All these evil things come from within and defileth the man. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, is the only source of purity. The only source of purity. The only one who can search the heart of man. He is the only one who can cleanse us and give us a new and pure heart of flesh. It is from the inside that this change must and will happen through Jesus Christ. Alone. Alone. The Bible tells us in Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. I will give you a heart of flesh. Our cleanliness is determined by our hearts. We must be made clean from the inside. And Jesus teaches us this truth in Matthew 23, verses 25 and 26. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye make clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. But within they are full of extortion and excess. Thou blind Pharisees, cleanse first that which is within the cup and platter, that the outside of them may be clean also. We must be cleansed from the inside out in order to be pure, in order to be clean, in order for us to receive our pure heart. As we are drawing near to God through His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, through prayer and the reading of His Word, we are granted cleansing and washed. We are washed clean from the inside out. As we draw near to God through His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, the only way, through prayer and through the reading of His holy word, we are granted cleansing and we are washed clean. We are washed clean. We are purified from the inside out. Oh, praise God. Praise God. In Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19 through 22, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which He hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, His flesh, and having an high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. It's by the mercy of God we can draw near to Him and be cleansed by the washing and of the generation that only He can give. It's only by God's mercy that we can draw near to Him and be cleansed. Be cleansed. Be cleansed. Be washed clean. Regenerated. Reconciled. Reconciled by the living water. By the living water, by the blood that He, by the blood that He shed for all of us who would believe, for the sins of the world. He died for us, Jesus Christ. In Titus chapter 3, verses 3 through 7, for we ourselves also were sometimes foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving diverse lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. But after that kindness and love of God, our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, He saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which He shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that being justified by His grace, we should be made heirs, according to the hope of eternal life. That being justified by His grace, we should be made heirs, according to the hope of eternal life. This is why Jesus prays for His sheep. He prays for His sheep to the Father in heaven, asking them to be sanctified by Him. Asking His Father in heaven to sanctify His sheep. He still now, to this day, is giving his life for each and every one of us. His time for each and every one of us. His blood for each and every one of us. Long suffering for us. For us. In this wonderful time of grace where he may still be found. He still may be found in this time of grace. You better find him. You better seek him. You better obey him. You better turn from your evil ways and turn to Christ and live. John 17:17. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Jesus is the word. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus can wash you clean. He's the only one. He can give you a new heart, a flesh, a pure heart. Only he can do it. Only he can cleanse you from the inside out. Don't try to hide from him any longer. The Apostle Paul gives us a loving example of this sanctifying truth and power that comes by the Word of God. And he tells us this in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 32. He tells us, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word, that he might present it to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be and holy and without blemish, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourish and cleanseth it, even as the Lord, the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. We are brought into fellowship with Christ and washed clean when we believe on him, confessing our sins and trespasses. As we confess our sins and trespasses to him in humble sincerity. Humble sincerity. We are brought into fellowship. No matter who you are. No matter what you've done. No matter where you've been or where you're going. Jesus will allow you to fellowship with him if you come to him humbly and sincerely and ask him to wash you clean, to set you free. I pray you ask him today. Be set free. Be set free. 1 John chapter 1, 6 through 10. Thank you, Father. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Acts 22:15-16, for thou shalt be his witness unto all men of what thou hast seen and heard. And now, why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized and washed, wash away thy sins. Wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. The only one who can wash you clean of your sins is Jesus Christ. Jesus. Jesus, come to him today. Be washed clean. Be washed clean. He's waiting for you. He's waiting for you. It is in the inner baptism that each person must go through in order to be born again from above. The physical act of water baptism does not save us. It is an outward representation of what has happened to us on the inside. It's a public, and it's a public profession to show everybody, look at me, I profess Christ. It's a confession of faith. It's an outward sign of an inward change. It's an outward sign of an inward change. When you profess Christ, when you proclaim Jesus, when you've been saved, when you've been set free, when you've been washed clean from the inside out, from the baptism of the washing of the blood that only Christ can wash you with and make you clean and allow you and grant you a pure heart. This is when you have been changed. This is when you have been reborn. This is when you have been set free by Christ alone. Praise God. Matthew 10:32-33. Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. Be warned today. Be warned today. If you deny Christ before men, you will be denied the Father in heaven by Jesus Christ. Romans 10:9-11. That if thou shalt confess that with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Thou shalt be saved, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Don't be ashamed of Jesus Christ. He's not ashamed of you. He's not ashamed of you. He's waiting for you today. Today. Today is the day of salvation. Today you can be set free. Today you can be washed clean by Jesus Christ. The only true source of purity is found in God. Those that sincerely seek after his wisdom will not be ashamed and will bear good fruit. You'll bear the good fruit of God. Wow. Doesn't that sound great? It sounds wonderful to me. James chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. Who is a wise man endued with knowledge among you? Who is a wise man endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness and wisdom. But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality, without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. That make peace. Are you a peacemaker? Do you know the peacemaker? Have you met him? Have you met Jesus? John chapter 3, verses 22 through 31. After these things came Jesus and his disciples into the land of Judea. And there he tarried with them and baptized. And John also was baptizing in Ainon and near Salim, because there was much water there. And they came and were baptized. For John was not yet cast into prison. Then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. And they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. Ye yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but that I am sent before him. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom which standeth and heareth him rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This is my joy. Therefore, this my joy, therefore, is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must decrease. He that cometh from above is above all. He that is of the earth is earthly and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from above is above all. He that cometh from above. He that cometh from heaven is above all. Wow. So he must increase, and we must decrease. He must increase in your life, and you must decrease in your ways. Seek out his way, the only way. Put your ways aside. Remember John. He worked. He did all these things. He baptized, but he knew he wasn't the Christ. They looked at him like he was the Christ, but he was rejoiceful knowing that Jesus Christ was coming to baptize, to save us, to set us free, to give us the Holy Ghost, to show us the way into heaven, the only way into heaven. We must allow him in our lives to increase as we decrease. We must surrender our lives to Jesus Christ. We must seek after him, obey him, take up our crosses and follow after him. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. You know, The beginning of wisdom, the Bible tells us, the beginning of wisdom is the fear of God. We must be and stay ready. We must be ready. We must continue to seek after Him every day, in every season. Our eyes and our hearts must be focused in purity upon the Lord's return. Are you waiting for Christ's return? Are you looking for Him? Are you looking for Him? Are you seeking Him? Are you obeying Him? Are you? I hope so. I hope so. Seek Him while He may be found. First John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it kneweth Him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when He shall appear, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. And every man that hath this hope in Him purifieth himself, even as He is pure. Jesus is pure. We must become pure. And the only way to become pure like Jesus is by Jesus, through Jesus. Jesus, He's our answer. Jesus is our answer. There is only one way for us to be made pure. Jesus. There's only one way for us to see God in heaven. That's through Jesus. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Amen. I pray that all today who seek out Christ would ask Him for a pure heart. For a pure heart, so that they would see God. So that they would see God. Now, the Apostle Paul warns us in Timothy, in First Timothy chapter 5, verse 22, to lay hands suddenly on no man, neither be partaker of other man's sins. Keep thyself pure. Keep thyself pure. Do you find yourself sometimes with friends or the people, the crowds, the places you go to? A situation may happen. Someone might say something. Someone might try to draw you into what's happening, into the event. Do you find yourself staying pure from these things? Or do you find yourself being drawn in? We must be aware. We must keep ourselves pure. The only way to do that is through God's Word, Jesus Christ. Keep yourself pure. Keep yourself pure. Be pure. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. And again, we are kept pure by abiding in Christ and abstaining from sin. This allows us to be a great example of purity to others. So instead of being drawn in by all these unpure things that are happening in the world, be the light. Be the purity of Christ. Be what he's called you to be. For the example to others. Show them. It's okay to say Jesus. It's okay to say I love Jesus. It's okay to say I'm saved. I'm a Christian. I want to go to heaven. I believe. It's okay. It's okay. Stand today on Jesus Christ. He stood for you. He stands for you. He always will for those who will believe on him. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12. Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Be this example. Christ will stand with you. Having a pure heart allows us to live a clean life with a clean conscience, in spirit, in truth. Jesus gives all believers in him the ability and desire to pray for one another, for those who are desperately in need of prayer, and they don't even know it. They don't even realize it. Be pure. Be prayerful for those in this world. And this action is the true sign of being washed and cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. When we put ourselves aside for others, just as Christ did, it is a wonderful, wonderful sign that you've been cleansed, that you've been washed clean from the inside out, that you've been purified by Jesus Christ. Think about it, my friends. Think about it. Seek out Christ today to be purified, to be cleansed, to be washed, to be set free. And show others this wonderful example of how Christ and his sacrifice, his love that he's bestowed on you. Show this to others that they may come to Christ today. For all who are outside of Christ, all who deny Christ, all who walk away from Jesus Christ, they're already condemned. They're already condemned. The Bible tells us to pray for them. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 3, I thank God whom I serve from my forefathers with pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers day and night. Pray. Pray, pray. It's what we can do. No one can stop you from praying. No one can take away your prayers. No one can tell you how to pray. Pray. Call upon the Father today through his Son, Jesus Christ. We as believers, pure in heart in Jesus Christ, must warn everyone of the destruction that comes to all who do not believe on him. We must warn them. We must warn them. And if we fail in this responsibility to warn others, the blood of their soul is on our hand. We must be aware. We must be aware. We must be responsible as Christ has been responsible for us. Ezekiel chapter 33, verse 4 through 9. Then whosoever heareth the sound of the trumpet and taketh not warning, if the sword come and take him away, his blood shall be upon his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet and took not warning, his blood shall be upon him. But he that taketh warning shall deliver his soul. But if the watchman see the sword come and blow not the trumpet, and the people be not warned, if the sword come and taketh away any person from among them, he is taken away from his iniquity. But his blood I will require at the watchman's hand. So thou, O son of man, I have set thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore, thou shalt hear the word of my mouth and warn them from me. When I say unto the wicked, O wicked man, thou shalt surely die if thou dost not speak aid to warn the wicked from his way, that wicked man shall die in his iniquity. But his blood I will require at thine hand. Nevertheless, if thou warn the wicked of his way to turn from it, if he do not turn from his way, he shall die in his iniquity. But thou hast delivered thy soul. Again, we must warn everyone of the destruction that comes to all who do not believe on Jesus Christ. We must warn them. We must warn them just as we were warned, just as we took heed to the warning. Acts 20, 25 through 28. And now, behold, I know that ye all among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God shall see my face no more. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. Which he hath purchased with his own blood. This is why the scriptures instructs us to feed ourselves and others the pure word of God, to pray without ceasing, teaching others to think upon the things that are pure and pleasing to God. We must teach others to be pure of heart. Pure of heart. And the only way to do that is through the word of God, through Jesus Christ. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good, of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Think on these things. What things are you putting before God? What's on your mind? What are your thoughts? What are you thinking of? Are your thoughts good? Are they virtuous and pure? What are you allowing into your house, into the temple of God? What's in your heart? What will you have to account for on that day of judgment that we will all stand before our Maker? What have you filled yourself with? Do you have a pure heart? Whom do you serve? Whom do you serve? James chapter 1, verse 27. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to visit the fatherless and the widows in their afflictions, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. Keep himself unspotted from the world. Titus chapter 1, verses 15 through 16. Unto the pure all things are pure, but unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure, but even their mind and conscience is defiled. They profess that they know God, but in their works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient unto every good work, reprobate. Unto every good work, reprobate. Don't be put into that position by God. Don't be turned to a reprobate mind. Those that refuse to abide in Christ, to remain in Him, to abstain from willful sin, to keep themselves unspotted from the world, from the unclean things, will face a severe, a horrifying, horrifying wrath from the Lord God Almighty. Read your Bible. The wrath of God is horrifying. It should frighten each and every one of you, each and every one of us. The Almighty God, the consuming fire, the Creator, the one who can destroy everything. The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 and 11. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Have you been washed? Have you been washed yet? Are you continuing in open rebellion? Have you been washed? Have you been cleansed? Have you been granted a pure heart, a flesh? Has your stony heart been removed and the pure heart, a flesh only given by God? Have you received that today? Or are you refusing to repent? Are you refusing to turn to Him? Are you refusing to be purified? Have you the knowledge of the truth but are content to be stiff-necked and proud before God? My friends, I pray that you and all who hear this would heed this warning today. Heed this warning today. Let me read 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 20 through 22. For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they had known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it is happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. How many times as Christians do we find ourselves turning back, looking back, going back to where we came from? Do you find yourself looking around? Do you find yourself desiring things that you have turned away from, that God has taken away from you? Have you returned as the dog to his vomit? After you've been washed clean, do you return to the wallowing in the mud? It is important for all of us to be conscious and aware of the state of mind we are in and where we stand in our lives. Those of us who fail to stand on the Word of God and the belief in Jesus Christ and His holy gospel will end up in hell. There are many of us in this world who put themselves, their needs, their wants, their lust and desires before God, causing them to be defiled in His sight. The Bible tells us that those without a pure heart, those without Jesus Christ, those who have not been washed and cleansed in the blood of the Lamb are condemned already. This is very clear. And this is a very clear choice that we must make in our lives, in all of our lives. And we must do this today and every day. Every day that we are granted life here in the flesh. We must remember that the time is short. Heaven or hell awaits us all. There is no other place for our souls to spend eternity. Heaven or hell. This is sure. God's word tells us. God has given us this great responsibility, this great opportunity, and we must grasp it. He has given us the ability to agree or disagree with Him. It is very clear that there is good and evil, light and dark, heaven or hell. We have choices. We have decisions that must be made and adhered to. We cannot blame the world. We cannot blame God. We cannot blame God for the decisions that we make. We cannot blame God for being true and just. We can only blame ourselves and the decisions that we make. The decisions that we make on our own, outside of Christ. We can only blame ourselves for these decisions, not Christ. And the outcome that we face is from our own fault when we do these things outside of Christ. When we turn away from God, when we deny Christ, when we deny God the Father, we will be denied. The Bible tells us, and it's very clear, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And there is a way that seems right unto a man. There is a way that seems right unto a man, but the ends thereof are the ways of death. So what is it? What is it for you today? What is your way today? Whom do you choose to serve today? Whom are you serving? God or man? Heaven or hell? Good or evil? Light or dark? What is your choice? What choice have you made? What is your decision? Do you choose life or death? Have you put yourself before others? Have you put yourself before God? Or will you surrender to Christ? Or will you surrender to Christ? Are you saved? Do you have a pure heart? Are you washed and cleansed in the blood of Jesus Christ? Have you been purified from the inside out? Are you warning others of the destruction that awaits all those who are lost, who don't know Jesus Christ, those who are not saved? Well, my friends, these are just some of the things we need to think about today and every day, each day that we awaken, that we come to life. We must put Christ first in our lives. We must call upon Him in all things. We must trust in Him in all things. We must obey Him for all things. We must be in Christ as He is in us, those that believe, those with a pure heart, those that have been set free, washed clean. What a wonderful gift. What a wonderful gift God has given us through His Son, Jesus Christ. I pray for all of you today that you think about these things. Give up to Christ today. He's the only way. He's the only way. Now, I'd like to call my wife Stacy up again to sing for us and praise and worship to God. Stacy, thank you.
My Jesus, I love thee. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee, all the follies of sin. First loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If tis now, I'll love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath, and say when the death do lies cold. Of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with a glittering crown on my brow.
Praise God. Thank you so much. That was wonderful. Now, in closing, let's bow our heads in prayer today to the Father God in heaven. Father, I thank you for the love that you have allowed me through your Son, Jesus Christ. I thank you for all things and all people that you have placed in my life. Father, I pray that you help us all today to understand the choices and the decisions that we must make and stand by. And that all the choices and decisions we make on our own will only lead us to failure. I pray for all of us to come to the knowledge of the truth, your holy word, through your Son, Jesus, by your great hand, drawing us near. Father, you tell us that if we draw near to you, you will draw near to us. I pray for all our souls that you would have mercy on us and grant us all the understanding of your word, that our faith may grow stronger each and every day, allowing us to stand firm through all the trials and tribulations of this world, and that we may all come to you in the day you call us. On the day you call us home through your Son, Jesus, our Savior, our Lord. And I hope and pray that all would have this pure heart that you have allowed those who would believe. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, today is the day of salvation. Come to Jesus Christ and live. Come to Jesus Christ and live. And again, I praise God the Father for our lives, our health. To all the brothers and sisters out there, keep the faith. I know we've lost some today and in the past, brothers and sisters, but our loss is God's gain. Keep thinking of the things, the good things from above. All things that we receive come from above, from God. So praise God today and every day. I say go in peace, and God's peace be with you. God bless you all, in Jesus' name. Amen.